Well, welcome to the Ignited Mentoring Series. My name is Robert Paris. I want to share a series of videos on overcoming the spirit of offense. As we look at the signs of the times, one of the signs that so often is ignored, overlooked, is the spirit of offense. And we need to understand that the enemy is working overtime to get you offended. And you can be offended at people, at yourself, or at the Lord. And in this episode, I want to talk about being offended at people. And I'm going to share insight on how you can overcome from Kathryn Kuhlman. Because she was a woman, of course, that went through a lot of hurt and had a lot of opportunity to get offended. Let me share with you a quick verse. But before we do, let's pray. Father, in the precious name of Jesus, I ask you to minister to each person. Father God, I thank you that you are the Lord who heals the brokenhearted. And I come against every spirit of offense, and I break its authority and power over their lives. I speak healing and restoration. I thank you, Father God, by your Spirit to pour on them fresh oil, that they would come to a place, Father God, they would be set free from every spirit of offense. Show them, give them revelation of the richness of your mercy. I thank you, and I declare them blessed, Father, in the precious name of Jesus. And the church said, amen. Now, in Revelations 3:11, he who has ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt by the second death. So we need to overcome. But there's a potential in this world which has fallen to be hurt. There's a potential to be offended. And in Matthew 24, verse 10, we discover that in this hour, many are getting offended. And because of that offense, as we look at the King James Version, it talks about offended, but in the New American Standard Version, it says that they fall away. And so many are falling away because that word offended has within it, as we can imagine, the term stubbing of the toe, where it causes a pain, it causes a anger, it causes a frustration. And I'm going to go in more detail over the next series of videos. But I want you to see that one of the strategies of the enemy, of course, it's always about the heart. And if he can get you offended, the word is choked. The word does not bear fruit in your life like it's supposed to. Now, Kathryn Kuhlman, let me just quote this scripture first. In Proverbs 23:35, they struck me, but I did not become ill or hurt. They beat me, but I did not know it. When shall I awake? I will seek another drink. And many people in this hour are walking hurt and broken, living in the world full of fear, discouragement, and depression. And how do they overcome? They have to make themselves numb through drugs, through drinks, or other things, and various other addictions to somehow blur out, somehow dull down the noise of all the hurt and all the pain. Because life is filled with pain and difficulty. But in Him, there's a place in the secret place where God, you come to a place of reality with Him, where you're real before Him, and He's able to minister and deal with the heart. He's able to do a heart surgery on you and set you free. And he whom the Son sets free is really free indeed. And one of the greatest freedoms that we need is the freedom from the hurt. If you can get freedom from that hurt, you can walk free from all the things the enemy's trying to addict you to and hold you slave to. Kathryn Kuhlman said this, talking about a woman that wrote to her suffering a similar story. Her life is a total wreckage, stripped of value, and her heart is filled with questions about ultimates, what purpose there is in anything. And that's what the enemy wants to do through her, is bring you to a place where all of a sudden, you know, the thing becomes so big and you lose all sense, like, what's the hope? What's my purpose? And everything is now taken out of context and becomes so big and so damaging that this thing that started off as a little offense has become a stronghold in your life that seeks to rob you of your true identity, declare that you are no good and useless, and everybody's against you. And it does not allow you to enter into the secret place where you need to have that relationship with the Lord. It wants to rob you of your rights and your inheritance in Christ. But God is calling to us to come today into the secret place. And I encourage you to check out the whole series on the secret place, because we need that in this hour. We need to find how to hide ourselves in the secret place of the Most High God. She said this, all she can feel is great aching, void, and emptiness, and a sense of futility about almost everything. She asked me the question, what can I do? And maybe you're there where it's a real place of futility. And maybe you're in a place where you've been so hurt. I mean, it's so close to the heart. Your world has been shaken, and you're in absolute despair and agony. And you cry out and you go to various people seeking help, but nobody wants to help you. And you've been so badly offended. And as I said, you know, Matthew 24:10, we got to understand that one of the things the enemy's after is this offense and betrayal to take you captive so that in this hour you are consumed in this, because the root of bitterness and offense produces and damages more people. Kathryn said this, God's word in Philippians 4:13 states, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. And God's word cannot and will not fail. Know that I can do all things. You can all do all things. There's a place in the secret place where we become real with the Lord, where we come to the place and understanding that, God, I present to you, I'm hurt, I'm broken. And I can be real and I can lay it at his feet. And God's real with us. And the greatest reality he brings to us is the reality of the truth of the word, where all of a sudden, by the Holy Spirit, the word speaks to us with such an authority and confidence, and you can cling to it. You can know that that word is greater, because the enemy's trying to persuade you that this attack, this offense, is so big, so damaging, and it wants to overcome and destroy you. But when we understand that we face a small devil and big Jesus, and that Jesus is much bigger than any offense, and that he's able by his word to enable you to go through this. Because that's what the enemy says, you can't make it through it this time. It's too big. And so that you quit and you pull back because you're so hurt. And we run back to our addictions because we see in front of ourselves this mountain that the enemy's painting that you're never going to get through. But in him, in the secret place, as you abide and reside in him, you can do all things. Because now the word has a greater reality and authority and a greater peace and a greater joy. In Hebrews 1:3, it says, and he, the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature, and he upholds all things by the word of his power. When he made purification of sins, he sat down at the right hand of majesty on high. When he made purification. So when we understand, when we receive that purification of sins and we put ourselves in this place, in the secret place, because through what Jesus did, the finished work of the cross, the veil was torn and you were given access to abide and reside permanently in the secret place of his presence. And there, he upholds all things, which he does anyways, but that's the place where we can receive that upholding of all things by the word of his power, where he is enabled and allowed to work in our lives and bring all things under the authority of his word. Because in Psalm 91, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow, under his mighty hands, under his authority, under that microclimate of his care and his love. And it's here in this place where he upholds. And so I know that as I cast this hurt, this care, this offense unto the Lord, he is able to care for me. He's able to uphold me. And as I submit to his lordship under his authority in my life, he now is able to work and do something bigger in and through these circumstances. So what God always wants to do is bigger. What the enemy wants to do is to destroy. He wants to come to kill, steal, and destroy. But the enemy does understand that Jesus came to give you life and that abundant, and he is the far surpassing victory. And if you surrender him, he is always able to bring and do something bigger. He's able to turn all things around for your good. Oh, the enemy hates that. Can't comprehend how God could, because he doesn't understand the mercies of God. Does she believe the word of God? If she believes it, she would do something about it. She is going to act like it, and she's going to gain the victory. And most of us have not come to the place in the secret place where we get a revelation of the word, where we're not just reading promises, but now as we stand before the one who wrote it, the very God who is the word, Jesus, and he speaks it to us, and we see in his eyes that we are the apple of his eyes. We see his hands and we see the nail holes and we understand the price paid for us. All of a sudden, the word carries a greater authority, and those promises we come in and possess because there's a revelation knowledge we gain of them. No longer a mental ascent, no longer a hearing and being inspired, but now there's a reality, there's a strength, there's a voice, and there's a clinging to, and it speaks. And because we receive that, and we mix faith with it, and we do it, it is impactful. it results and produces, and God watches over that to perform it. She said this, Kathryn Kuhlman, "It is a mistake for any of us to wait for some miracle to be formed from without, lifting us up out above our self-centeredness, above our fears and doubts. God wants to do a work from the inside out. We're always looking for God to change my circumstances first. And God said, I want to change you. And in the secret place, it's the place of reality, where we're real, where we come before Him and God begins to demonstrate He's real before us and changes us inside out. And He begins to demonstrate His love and care for us. And we come to believe and know that love that He has for us. And it becomes more real, stronger. And we come to a place where we're strong in the Lord, not strong in our offense. She said this, a person helps God from within by turning with outgoing love to others. And then miraculously, all fears, doubts, and self-centeredness vanish, but not until then. We have to read the word where when people persecute us, say things, attack us, how we are to respond. And as we respond correctly, and we learn to do the royal walk of love, because in 1 John, we discovered that if we love, we cannot hate. We cannot walk in that love, which we're commanded to walk in, that same love, the standard of love that Jesus had for us. And that's hard. But see, the enemy doesn't want you to walk in that love, because if you walk in that love, you overcome. If you walk in that love, it releases the very authority and power of heaven in your life that you are free. And you're no longer dependent upon that other person. And in fact, God is able to do something bigger and often reach and touch that person and beyond. But as long as we hold on to that hurt and that offense, we hinder and block God. And God wants to do something in your life and demonstrate the very Lordship of Jesus. In Psalm 31, verse 20, you hide them in the secret place of your presence from the conspiracies of man. You keep them secretly in a shelter from the strife of tongues. So in the secret place, listen, they may be coming after you, all kinds of words. They may be attacking you, but you're numb to it. See, the world's trying to get numb through various addictions and things to overcome a hurt that's already in them. But God wants you in the secret place to be under His shadow of His wings, kept so that those words bounce off you, have no impact. And no matter what the enemy tries or people say, it doesn't matter, because you ooze love. Oh, you'll bring the enemy to such a place of frustration and give him a heart attack as you respond differently. Now you respond in love. You let loose love. So when the pressure comes in that difficult trial where you're being squeezed, instead of coming out of you offense, instead of offense getting in you and coming out of you, rather there's a love. Because I've already been broken in the secret place. I've already been changed in the secret place. The miracle starts from within and not from without, Kathryn said. You must throw your will on the side of outgoing love. And you can't have that outgoing love until you reside in that place where He sheds His love continuously abroad in your hearts. And we grow day after day in that love, waxing strong in that love, because the fruit of the Spirit is love. And the more time I spend in His presence, I allow Him to manifest in me and through me and change me. I think different. There's a transfusion that occurs where the Holy Spirit pours into you His very personality, His very presence, his fruit comes forth in you. You can't help but love, because you see and you think differently. And now because you're kept, all these things, these arrows that are coming at you, which of course you read Psalm 91, those that abide permanently, all the promises and blessings of, including the arrows that will come at you, you're kept from. She said this, neither God nor man, however, can help you if you remain bottled up in yourself, in your own self-pity and your own self-centeredness. And as long as we close down, as long as we are so caught in our own hurt, and see, I've been there. I've been in a place where I was so badly hurt and looking for other people and always blaming other people. And it took a while for God to get a hold of me and break me and bring me to the place where He says, I'm the one who heals the brokenhearted. I'm the one you need. I'm the one, but you got to let it go. You got to trust me that I'm bigger and trust me that I care enough for you. If you'll spend time in the secret place and gaze upon me, you'll see that I've made you the very apple of my eye. I've carved you on the palm of my hand. You mean everything to me and you can trust me. And you'll see the price I paid for you and how I left the 99 and went after you. There's no wall that I wouldn't kick down. There's nothing that I wouldn't do to reach or touch or care for you and demonstrate that love. And I want you to come and know and believe in that love as you abide in the secret place, in my love. So that self-centeredness has to bow. But as long as I allow that to become a stronghold, it holds me captive. And I realize it's hard, but there's a decision we have to make to bring that stronghold and say, God, I give it to you. And sometimes it comes with a baptism of tears. It comes with a pain because there's a breaking of the heart and saying, God, I'm trusting this to you. And God knows how precious of sacrifice that is. So she said all this, all the medicine that you can take, all the device that I may be able to give you, all the sermons you may hear, everything that you might know mentally will never help you until you start doing something yourself. And I'm going to tell you the greatest thing you can do is to come into the secret place. Be real before the Lord. Tell him I'm really hurt. I really need you, but I'm going to trust you and I'm giving this to you. And I'm trusting that you are going to heal this heart. It's a place of real brokenness, and it's a place where we really make contact with the living God. Because it's your right. It's the blood-bought right. The finished work of the cross gave you access through the veil to the very presence, the secret place of his presence where God abides and where he calls and expects to meet with you. She said this, I urge you to get out of yourself or you will perish. Get out of yourself or you will remain a defeated person. And as long as you abide in your own self, as long as we're consumed by this thing, it will take you down a spiral. It will take you into a pit. It will take you back to all the death, all the discouragement, all the depression, all the hurt, all the fear, everything that so consumed you before you knew Jesus. And it'll make you forget. And we need to be forever reminded of what Jesus did and the freshness that he has for you today. There's always a greater place he has for you. He's always got something new for you. And he wants us to go deeper and further with him and have a life that's rich in peace, filled with joy, where we're always overcoming. And as we love on him, trust in him in the secret place, no matter what happens, he's always working everything for our good. No longer are we having everything working for our worse. And I've been there, where it took me to a place where one thing after another, after another, after another defeat, after another defeat. And I'm like, God, where are you? And God says, where are you? She said this, do you want to know something? I've learned that the victories that come cheap are cheap, and only those worth having come as a result of hard fighting. And sometimes that fighting becomes mighty hard and relentless. But those that are victories, that are worthwhile victories. And it's in the secret place. And as I said, it's sometimes not easy to let go, particularly when it's so close to the heart, particularly when it's such a earth-shaking, when it is such a thing that it threatens to utterly defeat us, where I surrender. And it may be minute by minute, day by day, hour by hour, whatever it may be. But I assure you, as you keep doing it, you get stronger day after day. As God infuses into you his strength, as you let go of your weakness, and you recognize in this frail human vessel that he is more than able, as you trust in the promise, not on how you feel, not on what you see, but I'm trusting in your promise, God. And day after day, I spend more time in prayer. And you're going to have to do this. I'm going to encourage you to take more time every day in his presence, more time in worship, more time that you get in worship and just truly lift him in awe of him, not just listening to music. I mean a real worship. And then you enter into the word and you have a relationship with him every day. Make this a habit. Instead of every day taking time to reside and think over the offense, take time to reside over the victory in him, over the word, what he said, and say, I choose this. And I choose this, even though it hurts. And there's times where you're going to go to bed and your pillow becomes soaked with tears, but you know that every tear is put in a bottle. And God, I'm giving it to you, and I'm trusting you, God. And I go back, and I keep a Bible beside my bed, and I would read the Bible every night, and I would keep reading it. And I get up, and I pray in the middle of the night, and I say, God, I'm broken. And nobody knows, but I'm broken, but I'm yielding this offense because it's held me captive for too long. And I want the liberty, because in this hour, you cannot afford to allow an offense to cause you to fall away or stumble. She said this, it was the Gethsemane's in my life, those hard battles and testing times when I felt I was almost crushed and the waters almost overflowed, that fashioned the qualities of courage and trust deep within me. Those victories that came easily were worth little. And the victories that come where we're crushed, it builds in you such a strength as you come to the place of truly connecting with him. Truly come to a place where you start to see his grace and power active in your life. And when you get out of it and you come to the place of victory and you know that he did it, because I look back and I see all that offense, all that hurt that I tried for years to overcome, couldn't. Tried, I read all the books, did all the things, couldn't. But in the secret place of his presence, there's something happened as I surrendered day after day, yielded to him. And I spent more time not focused on my hurts, but on him, on his glory and his goodness, on his mercy and how great he was. And I let the Holy Spirit speak to me. And I didn't want to. I wanted to always remind him I was hurt. But he said, stop focusing on that. He said, start focusing on my goodness, on my mercies, that this is the day the Lord has made. And I said, I don't think it. I don't feel like it. He said, this is the day the Lord has made. Rejoice and be glad in it. And every day I would get up, and every day I would start to declare it. Every day I would receive it. And I spend more time on that, less and less time on my offense. Something changed. Something began to break in me. No man or woman need ever be defeated on a single score unless they consent to be defeated. You may lose both feet, and yet there's victory. No matter what the enemy may steal from you, try to take from you, there is a victory because in him. I'm more than a conqueror in him. And so listen, though the Lord slay me, still I would trust him because I'm now found in him and I have such a confidence of his love. And I've discovered that what he can do, it doesn't matter about my circumstances. I've found such a peace and security in him. And I've gained a relationship, a reality of him that I never had. And now I can pray and enter in and see effectiveness. I can see results that I didn't have before. And I can enjoy a rich, vibrant life with him. There's such a revelation from the word that I didn't have. Why? Because I was so tainted by offense. She said this, this is a wonderful world that God has given us to. And this is a thing of living. The Christian life is a wonderful life. We can still smile in spite of our circumstances because the joy of the Lord is our strength. God wants you to have life in that abundant, even in this fallen world, even in the midst of it. God wants you to be so joyful, so triumphant, so having fun that the enemy, all those people that are offending you, you'll just cause them to wonder what the heck is going on. And they'll start to look at you and be drawn to what you have. Because we have a far surpassing victory. And God wants you to walk in that. And as you cling in, as you plug into the secret place, reside there, as you daily go after him, you're going to find that life and that abundant. And you begin to enjoy it. All depression, discouragement goes. Suddenly you can stop and smell the roses and you no longer get the offense, but the richness and wonders of his glory. She said this, I challenge you therefore to start enjoying your inheritance in Christ Jesus now. You need not wait another moment. Take him at his word. And we can come to the place where we recognize that he is our life, that he is our exceedingly great reward, that this is the day of salvation today. Don't put it off until tomorrow. Don't wait until you feel better about it. But today, come as you are, being real, because that's what the secret place is all about. Being real before God and saying, God, I am offended. And in that place, allow the Holy Spirit to speak to you and say, you need to, because he's going to be real with you. You need to repent of that. You need to forgive. And he's going to share with things that you need to do to get that thing out of you. We don't always like how God's going to cure us. But if you will trust him, he will bring you to a place where you are completely whole. Nothing missing, nothing lacking, and you enjoy life. And you have a vibrant, wonderful life, even in this fallen world, even in a perilous, difficult time. Knowing that you're called, appointed, anointed for such a time as this. Amen. Oh, I pray this is a very simple message, but I pray you're getting it and that you get into the secret place and don't allow the spirit of offense to rob you of your inheritance, of your identity, or cause you to fall away. Many will be offended in this hour, and there's going to be many opportunities to be offended, but you have a choice and you can choose to abide in the secret place, trust in him and receive that rich mercy and be kept. And in enjoy life and step up and do great things for God in this hour. And know that as you love in him, he's working all things for your good. Amen. Well, I pray this message has blessed you, encouraged you. Check out more in the secret place, more on the spirit of offense. And may they build you, help you, and encourage you. I ask you to consider liking, sharing, and subscribing, because as you do, this video reaches more people as we work with the algorithms at YouTube and Google. And I want to see more lives touched and changed, and understanding the spirit of offense in this hour and how, as they abide in the secret place, they can be free. I also encourage you to consider joining our prayer partnership team, because as you do, and it's easy, you can go to godsgenerousandrevivals.com, go to our partner page, you can sign up for free. If you're from an international country, you don't have to put down the state. All we really need is your email address. It costs you nothing. Now, if God puts in your heart to share with us financially, great. You're going to enable us to do great things. But we don't ask money. I'm not going to seek money off you. I want you to know that as you join that partnership team, you get invited to our Zoom meetings. You're going to hear messages that we don't preach on YouTube, that are not available. You get people that are praying, that as the Spirit of God moves them at any moment, at any time, we'll pray for you. You can't buy that. And we ask that you pray for us. And as a consequence of praying and standing as a partner with us, the reward that we get for the lives touched and impacted, you share with when we stand before the Lord when He returns. And I believe that's soon. I want to thank you for that. And I want to encourage you, as I said, to check out more videos in the series. May they encourage you, bless you. And I want you to know that we're praying for you. Be praying for us. In the precious name of Jesus, amen. Thank you.